The following preview is of a graphic audio production rated for mature audiences due to scenes of intense violence and sexual situations.
Available now from Graphic Audio.
Falcon, Mrs. Custer told me something that I'd never heard before. She told me that you were with her husband when he was killed.
I wasn't with him at the exact time he was killed. I was with Bentine and Reno when the general was killed.
Why haven't I heard this about you before?
Because my being there was an accident of sorts. A lot of good men gave their last full measure of devotion on that day. I never felt it was right to detract from their honor by interjecting myself.
I wonder, Falcon, would you share the story with me now?
It's been over 50 years, and I've never told this story to anyone before. I'm not sure I can do it justice. Well, I warn you, it's a long story.
I'm a novelist, Falcon. I deal in long stories. Please, go ahead.
Well now, the year 1876 was what historians would call an eventful year. In Philadelphia, they celebrated our country's centennial. Colorado became a state. They invented the telephone. And at a lonely place in Montana, General Custer and 265 brave men were killed.
This way! Damn! You're one hell of an engine fighter, Falcon. I've been at this game for a long time. I don't think I've ever seen anything like that.
I'll be damned.
What is it?
The Colorado Home Guard is missing 100 rifles. It looks like we just found a few of them.
You mean in addition to the Gatling guns we're looking for, there's also a bunch of repeating rifles out there?
Sweet fancy Moses, look at that!
Have you ever seen that many Indians at one time?
No, sir, I have not. Two Bears was right, these engines is coming from everywhere.
We have to tell Custer about this. I don't think he has any idea what he's letting himself in for.
You don't really know the General all that well, do you?
I haven't known him very long. Why do you ask?
Because it ain't gonna make no never mind what we tell him. He has his mind made up to go after the engines, and that's exactly what he's gonna do.
We've got them this time! We've got them, boys! Trumpeter Martin!
Don't miss the saga of Falcon McAllister at the Little Bighorn and Eagles 14, Bloodshed of Eagles. Available now in Graphic Audio.
And now for our feature presentation.
Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Rogue Angel number 20. Footprints. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Colleen Delany, Yasmin Tuazon, Joe Brack, Eric Messner, Thomas Penny, Elisabeth Demery, Mort Shelby, David Coyne, Michael Glenn, Lily Beacon, and Richard Rowan.
Annja Creed ducked around another thick pine tree and paused. A cool breeze blew through her hair, which she'd recently had cut, thinking she should take a chance and go for a new look. After her stylist had taken a good 6 inches off, she realized she'd made a mistake. 2 days after the haircut, Annja hid out in her Brooklyn loft, desperately wondering how long she could get away with her self-imposed hibernation. She didn't have any urgent commitments, and she wasn't due to film another segment of her popular cable television series, Chasing History's Monsters, for a few weeks. She realized that having a lot of downtime made her restless, and led to rash decisions like ill-advised makeovers. Then the email had arrived that changed her plans, and suddenly she was flying out to the Pacific Northwest. Now she stood in the forest on a trail that the guy who ran the combined gas station and grocery store had assured her would lead all the way to a small encampment hidden deep in the woods. He'd warned her sternly to stay on the trail or risk getting really lost. She could see what he meant. Since parking her rented Jeep at the entrance to the trailhead, she'd had a hard enough time just trying to find the trail itself. It was incredibly overgrown, almost as if the woods themselves were desperate to reclaim it from civilization. The email Annja had received was from an old friend named Jenny Chu. She and Jenny had taken many undergraduate courses together, and their friendship had blossomed over in-depth discussions about American folklore and legends. Jenny's passion was for things like the Lake Champlain Monster and the legends of the Sasquatch. The Sasquatch legend was why Annja was traipsing through the Oregon woods. Jenny's email suggested that she'd found new evidence of the creature's existence. It was evidence she wanted Annja to see as well, in case she wanted to do a segment about it on Chasing History's Monsters. Annja didn't believe for a second there would be any proof of a giant, hairy creature roaming the woods, but her producer, Doug Morrell, was a sucker for those types of stories. Besides, Annja figured she could buy some grow-out time before anyone she knew saw her hair. Annja smirked, thinking about the last time she'd seen Jenny and their debate. Jenny had gone on and on about how it was anthropologically possible for a giant ape man to exist in the farthest reaches of the forest of the North American continent.
You're talking about a missing link here, Jen, and it's just not possible. Not with the technology we have nowadays. You'd think we could float a satellite over certain areas and just get readings if there was anything there.
Jenny, her hair in two braids and her glasses slung low on her nose, rolled her eyes.
You trust technology way too much. It's not the magic bullet you think it is.
I don't think it's a magic bullet per se. Just that we have to acknowledge it could solve mysteries that we've created for ourselves.
I'll prove you wrong, Annja. One day. You'll see.
Was this the day Jenny had forecast? Annja smiled and started walking again, stepping carefully on the thick carpet of pine needles. She'd have to wait and see. Jenny's campsite was supposed to be set up about 2 miles farther down the trail. Annja took another 5 steps and paused again. Something didn't feel right. She turned and looked back the way she'd come. How many times had she suspected that someone was following her? The feeling was so ingrained that it had become the norm, but she couldn't discount it. Her safety might well be in jeopardy. It often was these days. That meant she'd have to take precautions, but if she stuck to the trail as she'd been told to do, there was a good chance that whoever or whatever was following her would overtake her. Whatever? She caught the mental slip and frowned. Was she already supposing that some giant creature might be tailing her? Shaking her head to clear it, Annja looked up and considered the sky. Despite the sunny start to the day, bloated clouds had moved in, threatening to drench the forest below. One thing was certain. If Annja didn't make some progress and reach the campsite, she was going to get soaked to the bone and face the threat of hypothermia. Even though the day was relatively warm, it was still early spring, and temperatures could fluctuate rapidly. Annja froze at the sound of the twig snapping and searched the woods around her.
I need cover.
She spotted a clump of bushes and ducked down into it, squeezing under until she could just about peer out from under the foliage. She sensed movement farther back on the path. Was it the creature Jenny had been hunting for? Or something else entirely? She spotted a set of boots and relaxed somewhat. The last she'd heard, the Sasquatch didn't wear trendy hiking boots. The feet were moving along at a casual pace. There wasn't any sense of menace. Annja poked her head out from under the bush. The hiking boots belonged to a boy of about 16. his jet-black hair spiked out of his head at odd angles, and he toppled back, landing on his butt as he reacted with shock to seeing Anya's head emerge from the bush.
Who are you?
Anya climbed to her feet and brushed bits of plant matter out of her hair.
Sorry about that. I thought someone might be following me.
You always go around hiding in blueberry bushes?
I've been known to hide in dumpsters, too. Trees, sand dunes, snow caves. You name it, I've done it.
She held out a hand, which he took, and she helped him to his feet.
Who are you?
Joey.
Nice to meet you. So where are you heading with that backpack stuffed as it is?
Down the trail, there's a camp. I'm spending my vacation working for an expedition that's camped farther in. I get to hang out, run some errands, and see what they're up to.
That wouldn't be Jenny Chu's expedition, would it?
Yeah. You know her?
She's an old friend of mine. She asked me to come out here and see what she was up to.
You're Annja Creed.
Guilty as charged.
Wow. You don't look anything like you do on television.
Yeah, well, I didn't bother going to hair and makeup before hiking through the woods. How about showing me exactly where the camp is? Those clouds look as if they're going to open up any second, and I don't want to be out here when it pours.
No sweat, Annja. Follow me.
Joey hefted his pack and set off. Annja followed along behind him.
You know this area well?
This is the land of my ancestors. We've been around here longer than anyone else.
You made a lot of noise on the trail back there. Might be time to study the skills of your ancestors.
What are you talking about?
On the trail. I heard you coming a mile away.
Lady, I move pretty quiet. I don't know what you heard, but it wasn't me. They don't call me Creeping Wolf for nothing.
If I didn't hear you, then what?
Let's not even go there, okay? No offense to your friend or anything, but she's kind of obsessed with this whole Sasquatch thing, you know? I can dig having an interest and all, but she's really going full speed into nutjob.
That sounds like Jenny.
It's cool. I get that way about things. Girls, mostly. But you have to know when to draw the line of becoming a lunatic.
Good advice.
The trail started to descend into what looked like a valley. Annja could see the trees starting to part as they entered a clearing. Ahead of her, she saw the bright reds and yellows of tents.
So, there it is.
I've been gone all day. I had to go back to town and get some more supplies.
Did you drive?
I walked.
Yeah, but town's 6 miles away.
And?
Never mind.
Like I said, I've been cruising these woods my whole life. I know them better than almost anyone else. And as the crow flies, the distance back to town is only 3 miles.
You fly too?
Sometimes that's exactly what it feels like.
They broke out of the forest and into the clearing. Joey walked ahead of Annja, leaving her to take in the camp. Suddenly, the hair on the back of Anya's neck stood up.
Joey.
What?
Where is everyone?
Joey turned and glanced around. They both stood for a moment, taking in the fact that there seemed to be absolutely no noise anywhere in the camp. Overhead, the clouds jostled together, and Annja felt the first few drops of rain starting to flick down at her. Uneasiness rippled through her as she turned and found herself facing the barrel of a gun. The man holding the rifle shot her a cold smile.
How nice. Another guest.
Annja turned her head slightly to warn Joey, but he had vanished. Startled, Annja turned back to the man. He was looking her up and down, and then he nodded.
Walk that way. If you try anything funny, I'll be more than happy to put a couple of holes into you.
Annja turned, and only took a couple of steps before she felt a rifle barrel jab into her spine. She risked a glance back at the man standing behind her.
That's not necessary. I'm perfectly capable of walking without you stabbing me with your gun every few seconds.
Shut up and walk.
Annja glanced around the camp as the man escorted her past the tents. Everything seemed to be in good order, and there wasn't an air of chaos. When they turned past one of the tents, she saw a number of the college students, an even mix of boys and girls, who had been working on the expedition. They looked very frightened and cowed by the two other armed men guarding them. One of the guards looked at Anya's escort.
Where'd she come from?
She's been on the trail leading here. Followed her for a few miles.
Sit her down with the others.
Where's Jenny?
Shut up!
Annja felt the jab of the rifle barrel again and sat down. She watched as the three armed men huddled together for a few seconds. They parted, and the one who seemed to be in charge, a guy of maybe 40 with thick pork chop sideburns and a long scar down one side of his face, nodded at her.
You!
What?
Stand up.
Annja tensed. Were they going to shoot her now? She closed her eyes and pictured the powerful sword she'd inherited from Joan of Arc. The weapon was ready for her to call forth. She opened her eyes and stood.
What's this all about?
Shut up! We've got a message for the professor.
Annja frowned. So this wasn't just some random occurrence. These guys wanted to speak to Jenny. But what had happened to her?
What?
Tell her to back off. She's not wanted here. These woods belong to us, and we'll do whatever it takes to keep it that way.
Okay, I'll give her the message.
You do that, and tell her we'll be watching. If we don't like what we see, then bad things will start happening.
I get it.
The lead man regarded her for one more second and then turned. The three men walked toward the trees that bordered the clearing. In minutes, they had vanished back into the gloom. Annja frowned. She turned and pulled one of the young men to his feet.
What the hell is going on around here?
Who are you?
I'm Annja Creed. Where is Jenny?
Jenny?
Professor Chu.
Although he was big and strapping, the student looked like he was about to faint.
Professor Chu went out on a hike this morning. We haven't seen her since.
None of you have seen her?
No. And those guys showed up about an hour ago? I guess they just got tired of waiting for her?
Maybe.
Maybe?
Perhaps they were only supposed to deliver the message. Maybe it's a scare tactic.
Yeah. Well, they succeeded.
Hey!
Annja turned and saw Joey standing behind her, sliding his backpack off.
Where the hell did you disappear to?
Creeping wolf, remember? I can disappear in the blink of an eye. Anyway, I don't do guns. I'm a lover, not a fighter.
Great. So, my creeping friend, maybe you can tell me what happened to Jenny?
How would I know? I've been gone all day getting supplies.
Annja frowned. He had a point. And none of the college kids looked as if they were going to be particularly keen to set out on a search through the woods. She knew what was coming. Annja looked at Joey again.
They'll want to leave.
Because of those guys? Wimps.
Didn't you just tell me you're a lover, not a fighter?
Sure, but I don't lay down for anyone either. If I did that, it wouldn't be much of a credit to my tribe.
Annja turned back to the student she'd spoken to initially. A little color was back in his face, so he probably wouldn't faint.
Get your gear packed up. You guys aren't staying here.
Instantly, the college students all sprang into action, taking down tents and getting their packs squared away. Annja watched them. She felt hesitant about taking command of the situation, but with Jenny nowhere to be seen, someone had to. She couldn't tell a bunch of kids to hang around with gun-toting nuts lurking in the woods, and she was pretty confident that Jenny would tell them to get out of there as well. There was no way Jenny would want kids under her care to be in danger. Annja went in search of Jenny's tent to pack that up, too. It took them 20 minutes to break down the camp. Joey spent most of the time complaining about the supplies he'd lugged back from town.
Hey, man, I'm still getting paid for this, right?
Annja fished out her wallet and gave him $50.
That enough?
Not bad. Jenny promised me $100 per day out here, though.
Don't push your luck. Jenny's on a university grant and has to watch all of her expenses. That 50's a gift and you know it.
Can't blame a dude for trying.
I've got one final assignment for you, Creeping Wolf.
Yeah?
You need to lead these kids back to the trailhead.
They stay on the trail, they'll be fine. They don't need me.
Annja pulled him closer and jerked her head in the direction of the scared students that stood huddled together, periodically glancing fearfully into the woods.
Take a look at their faces. Every one of them is terrified. If I let them go like this, they'll wander off the trail and die from exposure. You know that.
Yeah, I guess you're right. They do look pretty shell-shocked.
As opposed to you.
I left, man. I don't stick around for trouble. That's bad medicine.
Well, do me this one favor, and then you can get lost as well.
What about you?
I'll leave with you guys as a group, but somewhere along the trail, I'll bleed off. Don't try to find me. I'll search for Jenny, and we'll figure out what to do next.
You're going to find Jenny in these woods? Alone? You?
I'm pretty good at finding my way around, Joey. I've been in a lot worse environments than this.
At that moment, the clouds finally opened up, and rain pelted down from the sky, soaking everyone in seconds. Annja rolled her eyes and waved them over.
You're leaving.
Now? It's raining.
So the quicker we get out onto the trail and headed back to the trailhead, the better off you'll be. Move quickly and you'll stay warm, too. Joey here is going to lead us all out.
Can he do it?
Joey looked like he wanted to punch the student.
Yes. He knows these woods better than anyone.
What if we get lost?
You won't. I'll be bringing up the rear, so I'll make sure no one gets left behind. Now, are we ready?
They all nodded. Annja breathed a sigh of relief. If she could just keep them focused on the task at hand, getting back to the safety of town and away from here, then they'd be all right. She looked at Joey.
You all set?
Of course.
All right, then. Lead on.
Joey started off down the trail. One by one, the students fell in, forming a ragged line. Annja figured the trio of gunmen were probably watching them leave. She hoped they would think that Annja had just wanted to get everyone out in one piece. Hopefully, they would believe that their threats had worked, even though they hadn't. The trees seemed to reach in over them as they walked down the trail. Overhead, the long, spindly branches with leaf shoots and pine branches deflected some of the rain, but the trail was turning into a muddy mess. Annja did find it peculiar that none of the students had asked about Jenny's welfare. But then again, when faced with mortal danger, most people do end up only considering their own personal safety. Jenny was on her own. Well, not quite. As Joey led the group around a bend in the trail, Annja saw her chance and quietly stepped off the trail. She crouched low and then slipped behind a thick pine tree. The rain continued to fall, and the light in the sky seemed to be dimming by the second. It was already late afternoon, and the addition of bad weather meant that she was looking at spending a truly dark night in the woods. If Annja had initially believed that the rain would taper off as the evening progressed, she was wrong. Indeed, as the sky continued to darken, the rain increased until sheets fell from the clouds above her. The good news was that the weather was a great equalizer. The men with the guns would also have to seek refuge from the storm. 20 yards away, she spotted a downed tree. It was almost dry under the canopy of the dense pine. Annja could see the splintered trunk and reasoned it must have come down during a recent thunderstorm. It wasn't high enough to set up the tent under the branches, so she stretched the tent out and used it as a tarp. It was perfect to further protect her from the elements. There was no guarantee that the tent wouldn't fly away at the next gust of wind, but Annja was grateful she at least had something to keep the rain out of her face. The area was littered with pine boughs. The spring growth hadn't occurred yet, so they were obviously dead leftovers from before the winter snows. Still, she gathered enough for a bed and shoved them in under her shelter. Shivering from being wet and cold, Annja pulled out her knife and started scraping at the bark of the tree closest to her. The exterior of the bark was wet, but the interior was still reasonably dry. Annja produced a handful of shavings, protecting them from the rain with the curve of her body, and put them into a plastic bag, and then in her pocket to keep them as dry as possible. She hurried back to her shelter. Under the canopy of the tree, she also found a large pile of deadfall, and the branches were almost all dry. She hacked several into smaller lengths, and then scraped out a firebowl depression in the ground. On the bottom, she laid the tinder bundle and set some thin kindling sticks above it.
Here goes nothing.
She scraped her fire starter against the knife blade and saw the sparks fly into the tinder bundle. Several more tries produced a thin strand of smoke. She blew gently, feeding some more bits of twigs.
There we go. Good fire.
Heat radiated up toward her, but Annja shivered again, still cold in her wet clothes.
Got to dry these.
She added more wood to the flames and set two of the thicker logs nearby to begin burning. When she was satisfied she had a sustainable fire going, Annja removed her clothes. Her jacket was still fairly dry on the inside, but she'd gotten wet pretty much everywhere else. On the branches above her, Annja draped her clothes, letting the heat and smoke dry them out. Nude, she huddled closer to the fire, feeling the wood smoke curl up around her, wrapping her in its warmth. Annja rooted through her pack and found the energy bar she always kept there, along with the bottle of water she'd packed. Annja chewed her food and listened to the wind, and wondered if Jenny was out in that mess. She frowned. There was a chance that her friend would not survive the night without any of her camping gear. The wind, rain, and falling temperature together could kill even an experienced outdoors type. Still, Annja knew that Jenny was remarkably resilient, and she also had a lot of training. She finished her meal and then leaned back against the thick tree trunk. Thanks to the way the branches drooped almost to the ground, the heat from the fire warmed the area nicely. Annja felt relaxed and comfortable, despite the fact that she was sitting naked in the midst of a terrible storm. If she weren't worried about Jenny's whereabouts, she'd actually be having a great time. She touched her clothes. The heat was doing its job very nicely. She pulled them down and slid them back on. The body heat would finish drying them. She fed another log onto the fire, watching the flames jump around in the slight breeze that had managed to work its way inside the relative safety of the drooping tree. The heat enveloped her. Annja felt her eyelids drooping. She tried to blink away sleep, but she took another deep breath and nodded off. When she woke, the sun wasn't shining. In fact, it was still pitch black outside. It was dark inside the shelter as well. The fire had died out, and only smoldering red coals remained. She felt a small chill run up her back. She would need to keep better alert to ensure the fire didn't die out entirely. Annja reached for some sticks and carefully fed them into the coals. Fortunately, they were still hot enough. With careful blowing of air over them, they flared and caught. She set more branches on the small tongue of flame, resurrecting the fire. She glanced outward into the woods, but the firelight ruined her night vision. The rain had tapered off, but the wind continued to blast through the trees. It was tough trusting her ears when the wind seemed to overpower her ability to pick out details. The fire had compromised her relative invisibility. If those goons were out there looking for her, they would see its glow through the branches and know someone was in there. Annja closed her eyes and made sure the sword was ready to wield. She paused, trying to tell if something was moving around in the woods, but she doubted that she'd be able to detect a twig breaking underfoot. She'd have to go on her instincts alone. Annja took a deep breath and allowed herself to relax, slowly enabling her focus to expand outward like a circle around her. She had no evidence, but she couldn't shake the feeling that something was out there. But what was it? Maybe it was Jenny. Maybe it was one of the gunmen. Annja frowned. Did she really believe that gang would abandon the comforts of their camp to come out in the storm? It was doubtful. In the morning, they would become a problem. But right now, no. That meant there was something else out there. She shook her head. Being in the dark woods during a rainstorm all by herself could certainly make the idea of something like Bigfoot seem possible. In all likelihood, there was probably an animal out there just looking for a bit of something to eat. Maybe it had gotten a whiff of the fire and had come to see if there was any food to be had. Annja smiled. Not this time. Then the hair on her neck stood up again.
Okay, something is going on here.
Annja slowly got up on her haunches. She reached for her boots and slid them on, tucking the laces inside so she wouldn't have to tie them up. The wind blew another blast through the overhang, rattling the branches around her. Annja felt a small shower of water rain down on her from somewhere high overhead. She racked her brain for all of the animals that lived in these woods. She knew that there was fox, bear, coyote, but what else might call this place home? A wolf? Maybe a werewolf. Annja grinned in spite of herself. She'd been working with Doug Morell for too long. Werewolves were exactly what he'd be thinking about. She glanced up. She could climb into the branches for a look-see. She might be able to figure out what had her on edge. That didn't sound like a small animal. Annja reached up and threaded her way into the branches. With every move, more water fell on her. Something was definitely trying to get closer to the shelter. Annja climbed into the higher branches of the tree. She still had her knife on her belt, and she had her sword. The branches below her yawned and then snapped back. Annja kept climbing. Her pulse quickened. Wild packs of dogs sometimes roamed through the woods, and they would gladly tear a lone human apart without hesitation. She reached up for the next series of branches and pulled herself into a seated position about 20 feet up. Annja peered fruitlessly down into the dark and tangled limbs below. Something was destroying her camp. She could just make out the black shape moving back and forth. But it wasn't unrestrained carnage, more like calculated destruction. Whatever it was seemed to be searching for something. She could easily jump down and attack, but what would be the point? She was safe, and the idea of facing an unknown adversary didn't sit well with her. Suddenly, the branch supporting her cracked. The branch gave way. As she hit the ground, she tucked and turned into a roll. She rolled for some distance before coming to her feet. Underneath the canopy, something still lurked. Annja closed her eyes and summoned the sword. In the darkness, its blade glowed a dull silver. She caught a sudden glimpse of yellow and realized that there were two eyes staring out from under the tree canopy at her. It had to be a wolf. Annja stepped forward, keeping the blade in front of her. It was highly unlikely the animal was trying to kill her. She had inadvertently stumbled onto its territory, and the wolf was simply defending its home turf. Still, a threat was a threat. Steeling herself, she moved forward. There were things in the backpack she wanted, and she wasn't going to let the wolf tear it apart.
Get out of here! Scat!
Annja took a glance around her, trying to see if any of its packmates were near. It seemed likely that the wolf was a lone hunter. Annja knew the feeling.
You're not gonna kill him, are you?
Annja nearly fainted from fright, but recovered quickly enough to pivot and aim her sword into the darkness.
Hey, whoa! Be careful with that thing, lady!
Annja squinted and could just make out the form of another person in the shadows nearby.
Joey?
Yep.
Wanna tell me what you're doing wandering around out here in the dark?
Isn't it obvious? I'm looking for you.
Why? I can take care of myself, thank you.
Joey stepped out of the shadows, his eyes running along the length of the blade.
I can see that. Where did you get that thing? I didn't see you with it earlier today.
It's a tool I carry around with me.
Something that looks like that isn't what I'd call a tool, Annja. That thing has one purpose, to kill.
You'd be surprised what else it can do other than just take a life.
Yeah, you'll have to explain it to me. So, you got a wolf rummaging through your gear, huh?
You know it's a wolf?
Yep, I saw the tracks.
One wolf under the canopy and one wolf creeping outside. I'm surrounded, I guess.
At least you had the good sense to find some shelter. I would have come in sooner, but I picked up the wolf stalking you and I couldn't interfere.
Why not?
He's just doing what a wolf does.
Is it dangerous?
Sure, if he feels threatened.
Annja raised her eyebrows and glanced back at the canopy. She couldn't tell what the wolf was doing right then. There wasn't any movement in the darkness under the canopy.
You took the kids back to town?
Yeah, they're fine. I think they're leaving tomorrow.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.